They say, write what you know. And if there's one thing Captain Jack Crawford knew, it was America. Specifically the 19th century America that he helped define over the course of his life. Captain Jack Crawford, the poet scout, is probably the quintessential American man of the 19th century. He was a family man, an unfathomable horseman, an author, a poet, a renowned scout, a lecturer, a miner, a performer, a prospector, and the most famous figure of the West you've probably never heard of. Born in Ireland to Scottish parents, his family immigrated, like so many others, to lasso that big old American dream. It wouldn't be long before Crawford and his father found themselves in the Civil War with the younger Crawford in the 48th Pennsylvania. He was wounded 4 times in total at Spotsylvania and Petersburg, but out of it came a strange blessing. He was taught to read and write by a nun while recovering from his wounds at the Sisters of Mercy Hospital near Philadelphia. It allowed him to quit working in local coal mines, take a job as a postmaster, marry a local school teacher, and start a family. With a natural gift for storytelling, Crawford soon found himself as a newspaper man in Nebraska during the Black Hills Gold Rush. His employers sought coverage in the Dakotas area, and Jack was too happy to oblige. He became something of a local celebrity in the Dakotas, writing about the dangers of Native Americans, advice for pioneers, and even describing the life of a prospector. He worked not only as a writer while there, but also as a scout for both the 1874 Custer Expedition and the Black Hills Rangers. His burgeoning skills as both a writer and a scout would serve him well in the years to come. Now, at some point, Jack Crawford became friends with none other than Buffalo Bill Cody, who, after the slaughter of George Custer's men at the Battle of Little Bighorn, wrote to Crawford to join the 5th Cavalry as a scout. Crawford responded with the now famous poem, The Death of Custer, which simultaneously mourned Custer, expressed rage at the Native Americans, and promised Cody he would join him to seek vengeance. The final stanza reads, "And I will be with you, friend Cody. My might will go in with the boys. I shared all their hardships last winter. I shared all their sorrows and joys. So tell them I'm coming, friend William. I trust I will meet you ere long. Regards to the boys in the mountains, yours truly, in friendship still strong." Before he left on a train for Cheyenne and Fort Laramie to join up with General George Crook and the 5th Cav, he was given a spectacular gift of a new Winchester, a holster rig, hunting knife sheath, and a buckskin suit from his friends in the Black Hills for all he had done in the area. His courage, his temperance, hard work, writing, and personal flair had endeared him greatly to the local citizenry. He finally caught Crook and the 5th after a famous ride carrying some dispatches over 300 miles through perilous territory in just 5 days. Buffalo Bill even wrote of this trek in his own autobiography, as much for Crawford's, quote, pluck and courage as for the bottle of bourbon he transported as a gift from a mutual friend. Buffalo Bill remarked, "I don't believe there's another scout in the West that would have brought a full bottle of whiskey 300 miles." Already known then as the poet scout, he was well liked by the men. One officer stated, "Our campfires were lively after Captain Jack joined us. He sang his songs, told his stories, recited his poems, and kept his tireless jaw constantly wagging for our edification." Once Cody went back to show business in 1876, Crawford took over as Crook's chief of scouts, served admirably, took part in the horse meat march, which is just as pleasant as it sounds, and ended his tenure there later that same year with an act that made coast-to-coast headlines. Crook's men had won the Battle of Slim Buttes, a violent affair that was seldom willingly talked about afterwards by its participants. It was the first U.S. Army victory after Little Bighorn, and big news that the public desperately wanted to hear. In fact, the news was so big, and the public so desperate, that a race broke out between Crawford and another scout and the government couriers to deliver the dispatches of the victory. Crawford arrived first, after riding nearly 400 miles in 6 days. The race and his astounding pace were national news. The poet scout was now a celebrity. Befitting his newfound stardom, he worked in Buffalo Bill's Wild West show, joining Buffalo Bill Cody again, for just a bit before returning to scouting, writing, trading, publishing books, ranching, and even mining. On his New Mexico ranch, he met fellow poet James Barton Adams. Now, Adams only worked on the ranch from 1890 to 1892, but the two formed a close friendship and remained dear friends and in close correspondence even after Adams had moved away. Both men continued to write, though it was Crawford who in 1893 began to transition to life as a performer. He deigned to call his shows lectures, but instead, quote, a budget of jewels, sparkling, pathetic, humorous, and original. Glowing pictures of the beautiful borderland, recitations of his own quaint poems, thrilling stories of life in camp and field, exciting and humorous beyond the line of civilization, songs of the plains and mountains. With such advertising, he toured the country, entertaining thousands, spreading his message of temperance, but also giving the public something real, something beyond the dime novels. Crawford's stories came with an authenticity and earnestness that painted his audiences a true picture about life in the West. His performances shaped perceptions for decades to come. He wrote over 100 stories, 7 books of published poetry, unnumbered unpublished works, and 4 stage plays. His poet friend from his New Mexico ranch, James Barton Adams, again came into his life, writing the foreword to one of his books, and helped him edit and publish many of his other works. It was in this period where the two poets were again reconnected that not only was Crawford presented this exhibition-grade Winchester 1873 from the factory, but the following year, in 1903, he had it fitted with an additional presentation plaque and presented it to his good friend, James Barton Adams. Starting life as a carbine in 1895, it was factory converted into a rifle by Winchester in 1897 and displayed at numerous expositions around the turn of the century. It is every bit worthy of such a display, where millions upon millions of people would have seen it over a period of months at each exposition. With its bright gold and nickel finish, its deluxe, finely figured double X fancy grade stock, the original plaque reads, presented to Captain Jack Crawford by Winchester Repeating Arms Company, 1902. On the opposite side, on a silver heart-shaped inlay, reads the more poetic inscription to Adams. Christmas, 1903, to Jim from Jack. Go, sweetheart mine, look bright and shine for nature's bard. And take a sip from bitter cup of my old pard. It remained in the Adams family for approximately 90 years after. The sweetheart mentioned in the inscription, of course, is his prize Winchester. And it is not a small coincidence that Crawford even penned a poem published shortly after gifting this rifle to Adams entitled, To My Winchester, that several times referred to his Winchester as sweetheart. Now, of course, to speak of the poet scout, his captivating performances, his life, his evangelism of the West to captivated audiences, and of course this phenomenal Winchester, and to not recite his poem seems inadequate, an injustice even. And so we close with Crawford's To My Winchester. Sweetheart of mine, for years thy loyalty has proven true, as is the steel of which thou art created. There are no fickle vanities in you. Thy constancy might well be emulated. By beauteous sweetheart of a softer mold, whose eyes gleam love on every new adorer, who bends the pliant knee of God to gold and blesses every knight who bows before her at Cupid's shrine. My pretty pard, as loyal helpmate thou hast ever stood, facing with me the dangers placed before us, faithful mid trying scenes of war and blood, as when the skies of peace shone clearly o'er us. Mid all the trying hours of olden days, when peril threatened, thou hast never failed me. Loyal wert thou in many deadly frays, when painted foemen wickedly assailed me, and pressed me hard. Thou art not sweet in disposition unto all, my dear. To some thou art most spiteful in thy anger. Many have quailed in abject fright to hear thy ringing tone and war's resounding clangor. Although thy face may gleam with polished smiles, thou art a spitfire when the scene is fitting. And gone are all thy sweet coquettish wiles, when foes with mine their battle powers are pitting in war's mad heat. I love thee, dear, and love of loyal man was never placed upon a more deserving true companion. In western wanderings when peril faced, our daily life on plain and gloomy canyon, my trust in thee has never been betrayed. True as thy tempered steel, I've always found thee. In scenes of danger, I was not afraid, though savage foemen lurked in rocks around me, for thou wert near. Come, dear one, fling thy moody silence off and lift thy voice in song as in the days now gone forever. For all the dangers past, let us rejoice. I'll beat the time with thy quick-acting lever. Sing in thy wildest tones. Let not a note be soft as note from tender woman. Sing as thou didst when from thy fiery throat we hurled defiance at a foe inhuman. Sing, sweetheart, sing.